J. Let's rage.
I knew you were. You were gonna come to me.
And here you are.
But you better choose carefully.
Cause
I'm capable of anything. Of anything. And everything.
Make me your Aphrodite. Make me your one and only. Don't
make me your enemy. Your enemy. Your enemy.
So you wanna play with magic? Boy, you should know what you're falling for. Baby, do you dare to do this? Cause I'm coming at you like a dark horse.
What one particular element comes to mind?
Wire.
Copper.
Welcome to Chapter 7. Today we're going to be talking a little bit about emotional and behavioral disorders. These are the students that teachers are very, very nervous about serving. And as we go through this chapter, I'm going to try to reduce the number of times I say it's important to note. I will tell you, from filming these lectures, one of the best things that came about this is I'm starting to evaluate my own teacher style. And I suggest, if you ever get a chance to videotape yourself teaching a lesson, it's a good way to just look at your teaching style and make sure you're delivering the information the best way possible. All right, let's talk about students with emotional and behavioral disorders. These students present a number of different challenges. Typically, these students are difficult to teach. They struggle behaviorally, socially, and academically. These are students that may disrupt your classroom. We'll talk about internal and external behaviors in a little bit, but bottom line, these are students who have behaviors that have the potential to derail a good lesson. Compared to their general education peers, these students experience the least amount of academic success. And this is important. I want you guys to understand that this population of students needs academics, not just behavior. They're going to struggle academically, but once you get their behaviors under control, it's going to be really, really important to focus on those academics. These students also have greater learning deficits when it comes to students with learning disabilities, because their education is often disrupted by the behaviors they display. This continues on far beyond the school realm. You're looking at students continue to struggle with unemployment. They have poor interpersonal relationships due to limited social skills, and they often need mental health services later on down the road to control behavior, to control anxiety. And we'll talk a little bit more about what types of disabilities come under this umbrella. So how is ED defined? Students with emotional disorders. It's difficult to define just because it's so very subjective. As we've talked about behavior before, it's what you can observe and what does it look like. Well, when we look at IDEA, it's a condition that persists and adversely affects their educational performance. That's anything that's going to stop them from learning, stop them from being able to take in the lesson that you're trying to teach. It's also seen as an inability to learn that is not able to be explained by their health, their IQ, or any other sensory problems. If there's vision issues, hearing issues, intellectual disabilities, this is ruled out. It's an inability to learn that cannot be explained by other factors. This condition, unfortunately, also results in poor interpersonal behaviors and sometimes a pervasive mood of depression or just general unhappiness. This condition can also have students develop symptoms that are related to irrational fears. They can be really intense. They can have phobias related to schools. IDEA is criticized because it leads to an under-identification of students. It narrowly interprets school performance as simply academic. It emphasizes emotional problems. And it de-emphasizes behavioral problems. When we look at the National Mental Health and Special Education Coalition, they have a slightly different definition, and I wanted to just review this one with you because this condition includes responses that come from schools different from age-appropriate norms. Basically, it's taking the idea of what is expected by the school, by our culture, by age, by ethnicity norms, and is their behavior similar or different to that? Most of the time, it's going to be different. When they look at school performance, they also look at academic, social, vocational, and personal skills. Once again, when we talked about peer tutoring, how important is it to learn from others? How important is it for a student to have friendships, to learn through those social interactions? The coalition also said that, hey, you know what, this is not a temporary or an expected response. This is something that is pervasive. It's continually showing in multiple settings. It could happen at school, at home, on the playground, in the classroom. It can't just be in one environment. And the key here to their definition, this condition is unresponsive to direct intervention in general education. That means without some specific programming, without some specific behavioral plans, this student is unable to function in the general education classroom. And this disorder may also include schizophrenia, anxiety, or a number of other different disorders related to students with emotional or behavioral disabilities. Let's talk about the type of emotional or behavioral disorders. The first one I want to talk about, it's easy for us to see. They're called externalizing behaviors. And you're going to see a video in a little bit that'll help define these even further. But when we look at externalizing behaviors, these are behaviors that are aggressive behaviors, outwardly expressed. You can see them. Could be kids pushing, shoving, pinching, whatever it might be. Examples include a high level of irritating behavior. Well, you know what? What is irritating behavior? It's very subjective. What I think is irritating, you may not. These behaviors are also impulsive. They can be distracting and can include some persistent aggression. If you have these behaviors going on in your classroom, they are going to seriously disrupt your lessons. So if you have these students, you're going to have to come up with a plan in order to better serve them. Three common problems: hyperactivity, aggression, and delinquency. And as we learned from chapter 6, this condition is also highly comorbid with students with ADHD. Let's talk about internalizing behaviors for a moment. Internalizing behaviors are a little bit tougher to observe because these students are extremely, extremely easy to work with in your classroom because a lot of times they're just socially withdrawn. They're in the back of your classroom. They're quiet. They're not a bother. They don't draw attention. Some common examples include anorexia or bulimia, common eating disorders, depression, anxiety. And these are more common among girls. That just doesn't necessarily mean girls are the only ones that can get them. What we're looking at is these are more observed in the female population. I am sure males are just as susceptible to these, but in reality, these are also, these go undiscovered. These are our quiet students in the background. So these students could also include individuals with schizophrenia or students that are socially maladjusted, but these are low occurring disabilities. Once we start talking about schizophrenia and social maladjustment, these are not as prevalent. All right, so what are some of the characteristics you can expect from these students in class? And I take this with a grain of salt. I want you to evaluate each student as an individual, not just because, oh, they have this label, they're ED, they're gonna be tough in my class, they're gonna be a behavior problem. That's gonna cause a whole lot of problems. What I want you to do is evaluate each student individually. However, students with externalizing behaviors can exhibit some of the following issues in excess. They could throw tantrums. I talk about this in a lot of my classes. The best place to observe children having tantrums, why don't you take a walk through your local grocery store? I'll show you a picture here in a little bit, but all right, let's check it out. In a grocery store, really? Look at the cereal aisle. All the good cereals that adults want are up on our level. Where are the ones that our little kids want? Right at the bottom. What's that gonna cause? Kids grabbing it. It's at their eye level. You'll see a lot of good tantrums, a lot of good behavior to observe between a child and a parent just walking around the grocery store. Another behavior, simple non-compliance. Believe it or not, you may have some students in your class that may be non-compliant from time to time, so you better get prepared. We could also have some students exhibiting aggression, and in general, it turns out poor academic performance because we are focusing on their behavior, not on what they're learning. Students with internalizing problems may display depression or anxiety, some irrational fears associated with school, associated with social situations. So it's going to be important for you to be able to provide any type of intervention to help reduce those fears. Some additional characteristics, once again, social skills. They have poor social relationships because it's difficult for them to make friends. They have an inability to cope effectively with the expectations of social settings. It could be taking turns. It could be, you know, just being patient with one another or not interrupting during a conversation. It could also be the inappropriate expression of their desires and needs. Inappropriate meaning it could be not what society expects, not what we have a set of expectations. Think about how you would go about preparing for a job interview. And think about the language and the way you present yourself during an interview or a first date. It's tough for them to take their social register and change it and adapt to the surroundings socially, meaning that a lot of times inappropriate talk may be displayed in the classroom. They also have a lack of social competence, and with that, it could lead to delinquency and trouble with the law. A significant portion of the population I served while I was at Akron Public, beyond race, beyond gender, my students had some problems and some run-ins with the law. It's tough for them to follow the rules. Let's talk about prevalence. And yes, no, I didn't get shorter. I just adjusted the camera. So now I've lost about 5 inches here. So how prevalent is this? Children with emotional behavior disorders represent about 1% of our population. However, estimates look at this to be actually between 3% and 6%. And once again, sorry guys, males are disproportionately represented, just like students with ADHD. We know Asian American and Hispanic students are underrepresented in this population, and African American students are overrepresented. The way I look at it, a lot of the elementary school teachers and middle school teachers starting their first year going into urban districts aren't appropriately prepared to work with students from other cultures. Going back to chapter 3, it's going to be extremely important for you to be culturally competent, Know the expectations of the students in your class. Make sure they understand them and give the students time to learn your expectations. It's not all about your way or the highway. Even though a lot of teachers look at it going, it's my classroom. No, it's not. It's the student's classroom and you're there to help them learn. So as much as you can learn about their culture, their background, general expectations, the better you're going to be at delivering services. So what causes students with emotional and behavioral disorders? Once again, difficult to identify, and it's likely the result of three factors: biology, the home and community, and the school. All of those work together to help the student learn the social rules, social skills that they're going to need to be successful. So we're looking at multiple causes. What can we do to prevent students with emotional behavioral disorders from being affected academically? Once again, there's medical management. There can be a number of behavior modification medications that can be used. We're also looking at reducing overrepresentation. Dr. Ford does a lot of work in this area on reducing the overrepresentation of African Americans in special education settings. Once again, we said behavior is extremely subjective. So who's going to be running these judgments? Who's going to be placing these labels on students? It's going to be important we have culturally competent teachers for the 21st century. However, there are some great school-based interventions we can implement. This may be the first time you're hearing about these two approaches, but they are very, very popular and prevalent among the schools today. The first one is called positive behavioral supports, and the second one is functional behavioral assessments. Let's look at positive behavioral supports. So why do we need these in the schools? Behavior problems are the single most common reason why students are removed from the regular classroom. Think about that. The number one reason we move kids to a more restrictive setting is because of behavior. It's not because they're not academically competent. It's they're not socially competent for our classrooms. And even though students with extreme behavior problems represent only about 20% of school enrollment, they can account for over half of the incidents that schools have to deal with. So how have we reacted? What are we doing to react to these students in our classroom? We've come up with the great harsh punishment and zero tolerance policy that have just hit the news like wildfire. Almost every month you will see some type of story from students around the nation. Student got expelled for bringing a nail file to school. Student got expelled for bringing a plastic squirt gun to school. These are zero tolerance policies and they have to be in effect, but they haven't been effective at all in improving the climate in schools. And I work on the Juvenile Justice Board here in Akron. It has not done one thing to reduce the number of individuals entering the juvenile justice system. And 3 years after being excluded from school, 70% of these youth have been arrested. It's not working. These individuals need academic remediation, they need social skills, and denying them that is only going to cost society more down the road. We need a more proactive, more preventative approach. So let's look at what that means. Here's a school-wide system for school success. You can see on the left-hand side, this talks about academic instruction. The right side talks about behavioral instruction. And each follow a similar set of diagrams on the pyramid. As you can tell, we'll start from the bottom, the section in green. Under academic and behavioral instruction, we're looking at universal interventions. These are good for all students. We're looking to be preventative and we're looking to be proactive for students across settings. However, if our behavioral or academic interventions aren't working, we're going to take it to the next level, which is secondary interventions, which you can see in yellow. This is done only for some students. We want a rapid response. We want to do some small group intervention. We want to start doing things that are tied to specific student need. Some of these interventions can take place for maybe 8 to 12 weeks. Following these interventions, if it hasn't worked, we're going to move up one more level to tertiary interventions. These are assessment-based, high intensity. A lot of times they're going to be delivered one-on-one, and they're going to be based on the student's individualized needs. These are students that would be typically on IEPs. All right, so now you've seen just how these school systems are designed. You'll see this pyramid across multiple school interventions. When I Googled this, there's more than 100 of these types of diagrams. All of them use some form of this pyramid, and it's divided in a much similar fashion. However, what can you do in your classroom? So what do we know that works? Well, I can tell you this, behavior management systems or point systems can work. And any of these I talk about, they're not going to work for your whole class. They might only work for 70 to 80%. You're going to have multiple ways of managing your classroom behavior, multiple ways of being proactive, no matter what level, no matter what subject, in order to be effective. If there was one behavior program that worked for all students and I created it, you know where I'd be. I'd be on the beach at Key West somewhere going, man, I just made a ton of money. That's why we have to take multiple approaches. Not only one is not going to fit the needs of all your students. You might have a systematic intervention plan where you have a series of different interventions, a series of different rewards that work for students. You can find many examples of these in classroom management, where it might be a level system. It might be a whole system that students have to buy into in order to be successful. I like that. Here's a cute one. You can see this picture here is looking at different cards. How are they doing today? Green is good, yellow's caution, red is uh-oh. Probably a note or a phone call home is going to be appropriate. Why is this a good system? Because not only do you know how your students are doing, the students themselves can look up and monitor and see their behavior. This goes back to those self-monitoring strategies. Another good tactic, homeschool communication. You guys know on my website, on my business cards, I give out my cell number. Why do I do this? Because it's easier for me to put out fires before they get too big. I would rather talk to a student immediately when they have a problem versus waiting 2 to 3 days. You get frustrated, just how parents are going to get frustrated. So make sure you're contacting parents, letting them know how their child's doing. And not just when it's a bad day. You should be contacting parents on good days, letting them know how great their child did. They love to hear that. And it's important. If you're only going to call parents every single time their child does something wrong and not when they're doing it good, a lot of parents just won't pick up the phone. They don't want to hear about it. They don't want to hear you complain. They want to hear about what they can do to help their child succeed. Get peers involved whenever possible. Find good students, could be same age peers, or how about some peer mentors that might be a little bit older to come in and work with students. Students you know the kids already respect. They can be very, very powerful in helping change your child's behavior. How about your classroom structure? I know teachers don't like to think about this, but you know what? I've been in classrooms and sometimes it is the teacher. In a lot of cases, it's the teacher. If your classroom structure is set up and disorganized and students don't know what to expect, or your behavior intervention is inconsistent or not fair, this is going to have a profound effect on the respect students give you and the effect you're going to have on students when you're trying to reach them and teach them critical skills. Your book states supervised free periods. With a word of caution, supervised free periods. Students shouldn't have totally free periods unless it's got to be semi-structured. If not, if students don't have something to do, if they don't have an agenda, they're going to come up with their own. And a lot of times, it's not going to be parallel to what you think would be appropriate supervised free period. Give them options, things they can do. Not just, oh, you know what, I'm going to take the period off. That's when you're asking for problems. an unstructured classroom and unsupervised free periods are a disaster waiting to happen. Give you a perfect example. We started implementing in-school at a high school I was working at. In-school suspension. And all it was a teacher sitting in that room. It was actually a substitute teacher just monitoring students sitting there being quiet. Had no idea what was going on, but when I pulled up to the high school that day, the kids were, get this, they were sneaking textbooks out the window from the third floor. They were throwing textbooks. There was a pile of textbooks on the ground. They were supervised, not very well, but they didn't have a proper structure. So you know what? They decided, let's heave the textbooks out the window. I went up there and I would say politely directed the students to help collect the textbooks and bring them back upstairs. Once again, consistent standards. Have consistent standards in your classroom. If you are strict with this, your students will eventually respond. If you're going to be wishy-washy about it or enforce it one week and not the other week, you're going to be dead in the water. You need to have a plan day one. That's why they talk about teachers having summers off. Yeah, right. You should spend that at least the last couple weeks preparing and getting prepared for those students to come into your classroom so you can have a good year. If you start out wishy-washy, it's going to be really, really hard for you to catch back up and control your classroom. Okay, what are the assessment procedures we use for these students? Early identification is critical. Check out your book. Look at what they mean by soft signs. I'm not expecting you guys to know the screening tool, the systematic screening for behavior disorders. Your school and school psychologists most likely will have a set of assessments you should get familiar with. You need to know the scales. You need to know the scores. How is the information collected? So you can talk to parents regarding any assessment information you're given. We used response to intervention in schools now to help reduce the number of inappropriate referrals. That means if we see a student struggling behaviorally, if we see a student struggling academically, we intervene right away and start collecting data to find out what works. We want to provide interventions for success in general education. It's ridiculous. Why should we have to remove the student out of a general ed environment, put them in a special education environment for what? When we can deliver this information in the least restrictive environment. Remember, special education is a service, not a place, and it can be delivered anywhere. And once again, we do a wide range of assessments. There could be observations, checklists, formalized tests, curriculum-based measurements, whatever will be appropriate for the child at the time. All right, when it comes to assessment procedures, in our evaluation of students with emotional and behavior disorders, we evaluate their IEP goals. Your book talks about curriculum-based assessment, performance-based assessment. This could be observations, how students do in social situations. Are they reducing their level of profanity in the classroom? Are they becoming more socially appropriate compared to their same age peers? These students also have to take statewide achievement tests and are administered with other students. This can be difficult for them. Sometimes they might take these tests in shorter periods, or they might take them in separate settings. So, when we talk about database practices, we're looking at functional assessment-based interventions. Interventions based on why the behavior occurs. I'm going to show you a behavior plan in a moment. But what we're looking at is a descriptive set of procedures to identify what is going on prior to the behavior, what does the behavior actually look like, and what was the actual consequence the student received for performing whatever behavior it might be. All behaviors occur either to obtain or avoid attention, activities or tasks, or tangible or sensory conditions. Here's a quick video that will break down the ABCs of behavior, which is antecedent behavior and consequence, to help you better understand what we're talking about.
Hi, and welcome to the Smart Classroom Behavior Series. In this session, we'll be covering the ABCs of behavior. For this ABCs of behavior section, we will cover the following. We'll identify the three elements of the ABC analysis, describe each element, and practice completing an ABC analysis. Let's look at the cartoon. The cartoon shows a common experience that happens at home and in the classroom. We have a behavior that occurred, and now we have to figure out what happened and what to do about it. And this is where an ABC analysis can help. An ABC analysis can help us because an ABC analysis looks at what happens before, during, and after a target behavior occurs. An ABC analysis has three elements. A for antecedent, B for behavior, and C for consequence. Those are the ABCs of behavior. The A in the ABCs stands for antecedent. This refers to what is happening before the behavior occurs. It involves three elements. The first element is the setting. Where is the behavior taking place? Is the behavior occurring in the classroom, out on the playground, or in the cafeteria? Within the classroom, you can even look at areas such as your home center, science area, or reading area, because those are also individual settings within the classroom. Oftentimes, behavior is caused by something in the environment, and if we can find out that piece in the environment and change it, we can often remove the behavior. The second element is events. When is this behavior happening? During what time of the day is this behavior occurring? Is it occurring during morning announcements? Is it occurring during group time, work time, during center time, during a meal or a snack? Sometimes we can figure out why a behavior is occurring if we can see what's going on at the same time as the behavior. If we can change one of those elements, sometimes the behavior goes away on its own as well. The last element is interactions. Who is the child interacting with at the time the behavior occurs? Is it with another child? Is it with the teacher? Or is a child on their own? Oftentimes, certain behaviors occur with other individuals. And if we can figure that out, we can either change how the dynamic of that interaction or prohibit that interaction from happening. The B in ABC stands for behavior. The behavior component involves describing the behavior as it's happening now. There are three things you need to do when observing behavior. The first thing you need to do is be specific. Specific means you focus only on the target behavior. For example, if the target behavior you want to address is name calling, then looking at running in the classroom or hitting is going to take your focus away. The second thing you need to do is be detailed. When the behavior occurs, record everything that is said or done. For example, instead of saying the child called the teacher a name, you would say, the child stood next to the teacher and said, "You're a dummy," in a loud voice. The third thing you need to do is be objective. Objective means you record facts and not your opinion or interpretations of the behavior. For example, instead of saying he kicked the child viciously, you would say, he kicked the child hard in the leg. Having specific, detailed, and objective observations will give you good information to use when coming up with behavior strategies. The C in ABC stands for consequence. Consequences are what happens after a behavior occurs. When we hear the word consequence, we automatically think of punishment. However, in an ABC analysis, the consequence is actually a response by the person to the behavior. The person's response could be a punishment, but not always. So we need to look for three different responses. The first response is by the teacher or the adult in the situation, if there is one. How does the teacher address the behavior? In what way did the teacher respond? Did their teacher give a punishment? Did the teacher redirect the behavior? Or did the teacher not notice the behavior and did nothing? The other person involved in behavior is probably another child. What does each child do? For example, with name calling, the child that did the name calling, how does the child who was called the name respond? The last response we look for is the environment. While a response from the environment is rare, it can happen. An example would be a child bouncing a ball against the wall. If the ball bounces back and hits the child in the face, that's the environment responding. It's important to look at how each of these individuals responds to the behavior, because it could give us clues in how to address the behavior in the future, or even maybe that we're missing a behavior because we don't see it. So how do we conduct an ABC analysis? As teachers, it is difficult to observe and record all the ABCs of behavior as they are happening in the classroom. So it is recommended that you videotape behavior in your classroom and then look at it later. The first thing you need to do is identify a target behavior you want to address. An example would be a child yelling at another child. After you identify your target behavior, you need to create a simple ABC table. The ABC table has three columns, one for each letter of ABC. In each column, there are also the elements that you'll need to look for. After you've created your table, then you watch your video, and as you're watching the video of your behavior, you would complete the sections. For example, if you were looking at a child yelling at another child, you would want to describe where this is occurring. Is it in the classroom or on the playground? You'd want to describe what the child does while they're yelling. What do they say? What's their tone of voice? And then for consequence, you might write down what happens after the child does this. So we're going to practice this with the classroom video clip. Feel free to pause the video right now to create your own table and rewind to review some of the information that we've already covered. So here we have identified our target behavior and created an ABC table to record our information. The video you will watch is only 25 seconds, since that's how fast behavior occurs in the classroom. So feel free to pause and rewind as needed during the video to complete each section of the ABC chart. After you have finished your ABC analysis, you'll have a chance to see how you did.
Help the environment. This word is the environment. Let's feel the environment.
So here's our completed ABC analysis of the video clip with the yelling behavior. Take a moment to see how your analysis compares. Once you have an ABC analysis, you can look in each section for patterns or clues to help you address behavior. For example, under the A section, one of the triggers for the yelling was the child waving her headband too close to the other child's face. The teacher can look at this and think about ways to prevent that trigger from happening again. You can do this for each section. Once a teacher decides on a plan of action, she can repeat the steps in the ABC analysis to see if progress and change have occurred. So that's the ABCs of behavior. Good luck in your classroom.
Okay, I hope that video was helpful. But back to these database practices. Remember, interventions are going to include three parts. This can be making adjustments to what's happening beforehand. If there's something we know that caused the behavior, the antecedent, we could change what our environment looks like, change the structure of our classroom to help reduce the student's behavior. We could also increase the rate of reinforcement. I'm going to talk a little bit about reinforcement later, but it's going to be important for you to understand how can you make sure behaviors happen again? How can you make behaviors disappear from your classroom? And also removing the reinforcement of the targeting behavior, meaning that is there something in the classroom students are receiving for performing this behavior? Are they getting peer approval? Are they getting some type of tangible reward? Making sure that's removed from the environment so they can respond and behave more appropriately. I want to make it clear that functional assessments are not appropriate for all behaviors. If a student gets into a fight or has one misstep, that doesn't mean a functional behavior assessment has to occur. Functional behavior assessments and behavior intervention plans are designed for behaviors that happen consistently, daily, weekly. They're not going to have an impact on a student that, had one bad day. So what are the benefits of data-based practices? First of all, it involves teaching the students more appropriate behaviors, and it's respectful. It respects the student, it respects their level of understanding, and it respects their social skills. These do not include punishment. So you're aware, corporal punishment should never occur in school settings. That means you should never, never lay your hands on a child unless they are a danger to themselves or others. Unless they are a danger to themselves or others. And I'm going to add this one. And unless you've already had training. There is no reason you should ever place your hands on a student. It's just not appropriate. And it leaves you in a very precarious situation for lawsuits. As far as other punishing practices, reprimands, loss of privileges, withdrawal of attention, this is not what we're focusing on. We're focusing on positive behavioral supports and behavior strategies that are involved in intervention plans that are solid, are curricular adjustments, providing specific praise. Let them know that they did a good job, but let them know specifically what you liked about their performance. Tailor it to their specific need. And very beneficial reinforcement systems so they know how to work. We're all reinforced. All behavior is reinforced in some way. And students just need to see that connection, and you can help them do that.
This video shows a classroom behavior point system at Hartford Avenue University School. The classroom behavior point system works while after all of four transitions of the class, which in this video are the beginning of the class, whole group instruction, independent work, and cleanup, the teacher stops the class and they assess how they met the expectations and earn either a 0, a half, or a 1 for that transition. Students give a thumbs up, thumbs down on whether they met the expectations.
So that kind of concludes our welcome. Thumbs up or thumbs down. You came in, you found your spot, you got through announcements, you actively used your ears and your eyes. We're actively participating in that, thumbs up. If you weren't actively participating, a thumbs down. If you struggled a little bit, maybe a sideways thumb. I saw the majority of us were able to do it, so we've got our point for that. That's really good here.
Before each transition within the class period, the teacher uses pre-correction by reviewing the expectations with the students before entering the transition to ensure their understanding.
Just so before you get started working, just want to remind you of expectations for our third part of our work time. While you're working, the expectation is your eyes are on your work. The second expectation is that you're having quiet conversation. I'm not expecting silence after lunch. I'm not expecting silence after recess. That would be a setup for disaster. But what I do expect is that you talk quietly to people at your table. So if I'm at the purple table, I'm not going to be screaming across the art room to Katie. I'm going to have a quiet conversation amongst my peers, right? My third expectation, Spirit, is that if I need to get up to get something, I can handle myself with dignity. I can be responsible with my body, and I can respect those around me by just quietly walking without smacking people upside the head or throwing out slick comments, Ariana. I can just walk and do my business and come back. My fourth and final expectation for the work time is that if you need me to help, if you need me to be a second pair of eyes, an extra hand, you let me know by raising your hand.
Okay.
If you choose to get out of your seat and follow me around like a duckling, I ignore you like a ghost. Okay. I will only support students who have their hands raised and who have tried to practice, have tried it, and are feeling like they're coming up a little short. Then I'll work. Okay? Give me a thumbs up if you understand that. Excellent. So let's try it.
After their transition, which was independent work time, students vote on their behavior and the class gets a 0, half, or a 1 for that transition.
Back to that a little bit, work time. I really want you to think critically about how you did over work time. Remember your success criteria. Did you keep your eyes on your work? Did you raise your hand if you needed my help? If you had to, Spirit, get out of your seat to get something, were you able to move through the room without knocking someone in the head, saying something slick? Did you get part one and part two done? Remember, we wanted to expedite it and get both done. Did you do that? If you were able to do most of the success criteria, it's a thumbs up. If you weren't able to do any of it, it's a thumbs down. If you did it halfway, it's halfway. I only see half the class voting right now, and out of half of the class, I see a fair amount of people who did a great job, a fair amount of people who did okay, and I'm seeing some people be really honest and saying, you know what, I really kind of just, you know, flushed my day down the toilet today. We're in between right now, so I'd say we're at a half. And you know what, a half is all right, it means we're getting there.
At the end of the class period, the teacher goes through how many total points the class earned for their four transitions, with 4 points total as the max. And the teacher keeps a running total that can be used for in-class acknowledgments, such as extra free time or music played while working. As a class, they also discuss what type of day the whole class had. A 4 is a great day, a 3 is a good day, a 2 is an okay day, and a 1 is a bad day.
So as a community, we're up to 31. So as a community, we have 3.5 points today. What does that mean to us?
We was okay.
Go ahead, thanks for raising your hand.
Me?
Yeah.
We was okay, not perfect. We were good, but we
were good. Close, help her out, Lucy.
We didn't have a great day, but we worked well.
We didn't have a great day. We didn't have a good day. We were between the two. We're good moving into great. That's what it tells us.
Each student gives themselves a score for the day, which will be counted as their participation grade. Students each share out what they think should be their score for the day. The teacher reviews the student's scores after class to ensure he agrees.
Individually now, it can tell you how your day was. Were you on the side of the spectrum where it was good? Were you on that side of the spectrum where it was great? Were you maybe one of the few that it was just okay and held us from kind of moving that next level from being good to great?
The teacher gives a class list to one of the students as a reward, and the students read through the list and each student states their points for the day, either a 1, 2, 3, or 4. The teacher then reviews after class to ensure he agrees.
6, 3.
In review, the classroom point system works as the following. Before each transition, the expectations are reviewed and checked for understanding by all students. After each transition, the expectations are reviewed as a whole class, and all students give a thumbs up or thumbs down on whether they met the expectations. With class input, the teacher gives the class a 0, 1/2, or 1 for each transition. Points are totaled at the end of the class, and all students individually give themselves a 0, 1, 2, or 3 for the day, which is recorded by the teacher.
Before we move on from database practices to technology, I want to make sure you thoroughly understand what I mean by reinforcement systems. And I don't know if you've taken introductory psychology courses, but there's one concept that students continually confuse, and I want to try to set the record straight for you. So when it comes to managing your classroom, there are two ways you can do this. From a psychology standpoint, first we look at reinforcing behavior. If we're going to reinforce a behavior, we want that behavior to happen again. We're reinforcing it, we're rewarding it in a sense, because it's the behavior we want to see. So, whenever you hear the term reinforcement, you know that that's something that's good in your classroom. It's a behavior that's positive. So let's talk about two ways you can reinforce. The first is positive reinforcement. Well, what does that look like? It could look like anything. as long as students want to accept it. For instance, you are positively rewarded or positively reinforced on your job in a number of facets. First of all, your paycheck. It could be you feel an internal reward for the work you do. In the classroom, positive reinforcement could be any type of tangible. It could be food, which I caution the use of, but a lot of teachers will use food as a reinforcer. It might also be a star on a chart. It might be a token or something a student can use to return for some type of reward a teacher has set up in the classroom for later on. So positive reinforcement means we're presenting something to the student as a reward for good behavior. Now, this is where it gets confusing. Take a deep breath. Negative reinforcement. Negative reinforcement means we're going to take something away that the student already doesn't like in the environment because they did a good job. For instance, you worked very well for the past 15 minutes on your math problems. So instead of your homework being 15 math problems, you now only have to do 10. You took away something in the environment the student already didn't like. Parents, you do this all the time. For instance, if you eat all of your broccoli, you don't have to eat your cauliflower. That's if the child finds cauliflower not so appealing. We use that in everyday life too. If I take out the trash every Thursday like I'm supposed to, my wife takes away the nagging and yelling she always does at me if I don't do it. I hope she doesn't see this. Anyway, negative reinforcement means you're taking something away in the environment that the student already doesn't like. Another good example would be if you had perfect attendance as a teacher in a school, the school often reward teachers with an extra day off. That's a perfect example of negative reinforcement. All right, so now we've got reinforcement down, but what's punishment all about? There's positive punishment and negative punishment. Positive punishment is not to be used in schools. A lot of times, this is introducing an aversive or something that the student doesn't like. These are very, very sketchy at best, but positive punishment is, it could be in the form of spanking. It could be in the form of physical punishment. It could be presenting something the student finds unpleasant. Negative punishment is where timeout comes in. You're taking something away from them that they already like. Now, when it comes to timeout, lots of parents go, it doesn't work. And a lot of times it might not for a particular student, but remember, in order for there to be timeout, there has to be time in. There has to be something going on in the environment the child wants to participate in. So when it comes to punishment, punishment is for reducing behaviors. Reinforcement is for increasing behaviors. Do not confuse negative reinforcement with punishment. Remember, anytime you see reinforcement, that's a good thing. All right, once again, let's look at technology. One item that was mentioned in your text was a motivator. It's kind of neat. It's a relatively inexpensive device that students can wear on their belt or wristband. They're much smaller than this outdated version here, but it works similar to a pager that prompts students to remind them. I don't even know if you guys know what a pager is anymore. Time flies and so does technology. Students can carry this around, and it's kind of like, these also used to be called pocket elephants. It was just something that could remind students to stay on task and help with self-monitoring. That's the best part about it. Once you teach a student to use any piece of technology like this, it can help them do self-reinforcement, self-monitoring of their behavior, and this also helps increase the student's self-esteem. So, when these students get older, we're unfortunately experiencing across this state, our students with emotional and behavior disorders have poor outcomes. These students are difficult to employ, and far fewer of them are able to attend post-secondary education or go on to college. My students had a tremendous problem on the job, if they weren't properly prepared before they went out. They experience a high rate of unemployment and underemployment, which means underemployment means they're not making the money they should be compared to their same age peers, meaning that they're in jobs that they don't necessarily move up. These individuals experience a high rate of divorce and have frequent need for mental health services. One service in this area that offers a lot of behavioral and mental health services is the Blick Clinic. Blick Clinic helps individuals that have a number of anxiety or psychiatric disorders and will help them secure a place to live in group homes. They work on employment programs, social skills, things like that. These students are also going to have problems with interpersonal relationships. So there's a lot of these problems do not go away once the school bell is rang. These carry on through adulthood. And of course, we know our students are unfortunately experience problems with the law. I spent a lot of time visiting a few of my students that were incarcerated over weekends, things that they may have gotten in trouble for. In Akron Public, you might hear it called Dan Street. They just call it because that's the street it's on. So how are we going to collaborate with teachers and parents in the future? There's still a lot of controversy over the fact, are we delivering the free and appropriate public education in the least restrictive environment? And let me tell you, for those of you who are going to be teachers out there in general ed, a lot of you guys are not equipped to deal with the needs of these students. Do not expect your classrooms to automatically run perfectly. A good teacher works at it. When you're out in the field and you're observing, you're like, wow, this looks easy. It's not. Teachers spend time building relationships with their students, building relationship for their classroom in order for you to come in there and observe. And I want you to be able to model this when you get out there. Be able to handle a wide array of students and have respect for those students so they have respect for you. We also know that these students have a low rate of inclusion. These students need intensive direct instruction to learn the correct social behaviors. And you're not going to be able to just teach them in a vacuum. You're going to have to teach them while doing. These behaviors are very, very tough to teach in a classroom. Best way to do it, get involved with your students in the community. Students have the right to receive an appropriate and individualized special education plan despite of their placement. So a lot of times you might have to deliver these services maybe in a separate school, a residential setting. The adults that I work with at Blick on the board, they are served a lot in home. They might see a lot of services through the juvenile justice system. Currently right now, the Juvenile Justice Alternatives Initiative here in Akron are looking at more appropriate ways to serve our students. Judge Tedesio is doing a fantastic job. These students may also be served in hospitals or institutions. So what do these services look like? Collaboration with related service providers is going to be critical if you're working with students with any of these disabilities. Mental health providers provide wraparound services. It's not just supporting the student, it's also supporting their family. And it's support across many agencies. Ones that can help focus on teaching community skills, teaching behavioral skills, teaching academics and social skills. You may also be asked to be part of a positive behavior support team. This can help promote students' positive practices. It can help improve inclusive practices that benefit our students greatly. Think about it. If you want students to learn appropriate behaviors, putting all the students with behavior disorders in one classroom isn't going to help. You're going to come out with students that are just, they have a wider bag of tricks of behaviors to display. They need to see good behaviors. They need to have good role models. And teams can provide students with targeted support. They could also come up with support groups, clubs, whatever a student is going to need to be higher functioning, to be a better student, to be more well-behaved in your classroom. There are a lot of screening tools that will identify students that are, you know, not having their needs met. you're going to have to do a lot of investigation and a lot of observation in your classroom. I say this over and over. If you truly have a passion for education and you truly want and love to serve students, you're going to have an easy time with this. If you're in this just because you want to be a teacher, you want to have summers off, it's going to be a long, long road. Not too late to change it, but I think most of you are going to be able to handle it. Let's get into families. When it comes to working with families with students with emotional behavior disorders, some of these families, in my experience, can be very guarded. And that is a result of the experience they've had with the educational system so far. The families often blame for their children's problems. I don't have children, however, I've got that lousy dog that's probably somewhere chewing on my shoes. Yeah, I take total responsibility every time he does something wrong. It's tough. When I talk to my sister and my brother, they really take their children's behavior seriously because they feel like it's going to be an extension of their behavior and labeled as their fault. Well, when in reality, a lot of families are doing the best job they can with a child that's struggling from a psychiatric disorder or an emotional or behavioral disorder, and they just don't want to be blamed. Parent involvement, though, is going to be critical in achieving good outcomes. You're not going to be able to change the child's behavior all by yourself. You're going to have to work with parents in order to come up with appropriate interventions. Problems often associated with having a child with an emotional or behavioral disorder, let's face it, they're going to be increasingly stressed. I've never seen a parent walk out of the grocery store after a child's thrown a temper tantrum, smiling, going, "What a great day." It's a stressful, anxiety-provoking situation. They're also going to have an increased financial burden. Some of these parents are going to have to stay home with their child a lot more than they would if their child didn't have this disability. They may also feel social isolation due to the fact that their child doesn't interact well with others. And there's a lot of time and energy demands that come with this. So be patient with parents. Educators, you need to establish an open line of communication. I'm not saying you have to give out your cell number on a business card like I do. However, you at least need to have some type of way a parent can contact you, whether it's through emails, whether it's through a phone call, a voicemail, something the parents can do to reach out. And families are often going to need a lot of extra assistance in getting into the healthcare system. The best thing you can do if you're working with this population is get familiar with the services in your community that can provide the help and assistance to families they're going to need. Number one place to go to around the Akron area, go to Children's Hospital. They have a myriad of services and information that they can offer. They collect this stuff so they can give it to the families and their patients. Take advantage of that. All right, let's review what we've learned so far. Let's see how you would do on these three questions. Students with emotional and behavioral disorders are typically educated in what settings? Is it self-contained classrooms, a variety of settings, the juvenile justice system, or institutions? That's right, a variety of settings. It is true, they are in self-contained classrooms, juvenile justice system, and institutions, but they're also in the general education setting. So it's important to realize that there is a continuum of placements for these students, and they'll be in a variety of different settings. Let's try another one. This approach may rectify problems before they become serious and avoid the need for medication to control behavior and reduce the stress in the family. Am I talking about positive behavioral supports, screening tools, manifestation determination, or early intervention? That's right, early intervention. We want to be proactive in our educational implementation. We want to make sure we intervene early and effectively to help control students' behavior and reduce family stress overall. One more. A little longer, but when conducting a functional behavior assessment, this teacher notices that Jason's behavior outbursts frequently occur after the teacher has handed him a worksheet to complete. When Jason displays this behavior, he is usually sent to the principal's office. In this case, the act of handing Jason a worksheet would be considered what? Would it be the antecedent? Would it be the target behavior? Would it be the consequence? Or would it be the reinforcer? That's right. After what I've talked about in the videos you saw, handing Jason that piece of paper was the antecedent to his behavioral outburst. It's what happened beforehand and is a potential cause that needs to be investigated by Mr. Miller. Well, that's all I have for you on students with emotional and behavioral disorders. Make sure you pay attention, sign up for my YouTube site. There'll be another video coming shortly on students with intellectual disabilities, and then we'll get into students with hearing impairments, and that'll be the end of our first module. We'll also have a section on students with health and medical impairments. So looking forward to working with you on these topics. Remember, any questions, any concerns, just get a hold of me. Thanks again. All right, here's some bonus content. This is the functional behavior assessment I talked about earlier in the chapter. This is a standard form that's used by most of the schools. And as you can see here, there's numerous sections that teachers need to fill out and explore. First, we're looking at the description of the behavior. Exactly what are you observing? This makes it a little less subjective, and you have the settings in which it occurs. How frequent is it? How intense is the behavior? How long does it last? What have you done beforehand? And how is it affecting the student's education? Across the top, there's various ways that you can look at this information through student interviews, parent interviews. How did you collect this information? On the next page of the document, we get into a hypothesis for why do you think the behavior is actually occurring? You're looking for the function of the behavior. Not all of these sections will be filled out. We're looking at, is it emotional regulation? Is it a cognitive issue? Is it something that's being reinforced? Is it being modeled in the classroom? Are there family issues involved? Is it a communication need? Or it could be a issue of curriculum or instruction. Once this is hypothesized and the team agrees, the next step would be to write a behavioral intervention plan. This intervention plan is similar to the old IEP form, but in general, it looks at what are you going to do? How are you going to intervene? And you can see at the bottom, there's signatures for all of the team members. This is just a basic
Teacher's Toolbox. I'm Catherine Fortin, and today we're going to talk about behavior management. Behavior management is something that as teachers we all need to work on, and it's kind of a daily practice as I see it in my classes. Even after all the years of teaching I've had and continue to have, I practice on it daily. And there are top 10 behavior management tips that I'm going to give you today that hopefully will give you some clarity and help you out if you ever have some problem spots. Now, the first thing, number one, the teacher needs to do is establish trust and rapport with your students. Often, behavior problems and disruptions come from a place of anxiety in students. And we found over the years that if you just let your students know that you will meet their needs, and it may not be on their terms, but you will meet their needs, and you've had a lot of experience, and you know what you're doing, that often they do become more trusting of what you have to offer every day. So establish that trust and rapport. Number two, pace and manage class activities in a seamless flow. This took me lots of practice, and I realized if I kept my students busy every minute of the class, first of all, with a variety of activities, and secondly, if my transitions were very clear to them and smooth, then there wasn't any time for any behavior problems. Make sure that you give the students enough time to do activities, whether they're written or conversational, but let them know when you are transitioning into something else, and just keep that flow going from the minute they sit down with some sort of bell ringer activity, like a daily writing activity or partner conversation, until the very end of class when you might have a student recap what went on during the whole class. And that way, if your classes are tight, no gaps, no holes, you'll really minimize disruptions and behavior problems. Number three, circulate constantly in and among your students. This is something that we see frequently in class observations where teacher is standing up in front the entire time, or teacher is standing in a corner. That is a recipe for students to immediately become distracted and the behavior issues start arising. Walk around their seats, walk amongst them, teach from different corners of the room. Something I've often tried is to try to teach from a different place in the room every single class, and just constantly move yourself. I often move around with my clipboard, making notes on students, and so they know that they're being held accountable no matter what the activity. Number four, seating charts. The most basic education 101 tool for the classroom. But again, especially in the secondary years, we often tend to forget about them. Students talk us out of a seating chart, but boy, are they effective. Different seating arrangements can really help the behavior and focus of a class. In my classes, I frequently move the seating around. We have a different seating arrangement for taking assessments, partner activity, group activity, and for when I present a lesson. I do tend to think that a better seating arrangement for instruction is where the teacher is in the center of the room, if possible, and the seats are arranged in formation around him or her. This way you can spin around and walk around the whole time you're teaching and really keep an eye on things. And if you're a moving target, students have to pay attention to you. So make sure you circulate, you're on your feet and moving the whole classroom. Five, incentives. Students need incentives. They need good incentives for good behavior, as in participation for the older kids, stickers or stamps for the younger kids. They need those incentives to behave well and focus and be prepared and do what they need to do. Number six, behavioral goals. This is a great tool if you have a group or the whole class of students who spiraled into disruptive behaviors. And what I've done is take 5 minutes of English at the beginning of class, and I've literally said to a group, my goals for you this class are to A, not talk to your neighbor, B, raise your hand when you need to say something, and C, stay seated unless you need to get up to sharpen a pencil or go to the bathroom. Those are very specific, and you need to tailor them depending on the age. And then I write them on the board in English, or maybe in English and the target language for the older students. If you have a group that needs this, they need over behavioral goals and instruction and direction the entire class. And you do find yourself using a lot of the time for this, but it really is worth it in the end. So set behavioral goals. My goal for you, this class. Seven, logical negative consequences. Diane and I recommend the book Love and Logic. It's a parenting book for all age groups, and we use quite a few of the techniques in the classroom. Logical negative consequences are consequences that happen naturally and logically to a student who is disruptive or misbehaves. And you can explain those at the beginning of class. For the older students, they can be point deductions. Younger students, you can have them come in for a time of recess. But it's never something so big and so punitive that the student becomes disheartened. It's a brief, slightly negative and logical consequence. And remember the book, Love and Logic. They're wonderful. And eight, address individual behavioral problems individually. If you have a student who tends to be distractible, disruptive, and doesn't really seem to have a handle on his or her own behavior, address this individually, alone with the student, apart from the class. If you address this to the student in front of the class, it will backfire and you may get your place in a situation you never have rapport with that student. So remember, always address individual behavior problems and disruptions individually. Number 9, turn those ringleaders into class leaders. This is one of my favorites. Ringleaders are often very socially powerful and very clever and savvy in some ways. And if you get a ringleader on your side, ask them to help you. Ask them to do some jobs in the class or just talk to them one-on-one, especially at the high school level. That ringleader will do anything for you and will become your behavioral enforcer, I found. So get that ringleader to be your class leader. And number 10, stay close to the problem spots. This relates to circulating constantly in the classroom. If you go and give some instruction right behind the shoulder of a behavioral student or child, that child or student tends to not be as distracting. So again, stay close to those problem spots. As teachers, we don't want to isolate ourselves away from the class, especially in foreign language. We want to be within and among the students, and the students want to get to know you personally. As they do get to know you personally, again, their guard drops, your guard drops, and the trust and rapport really builds. If you have any questions or would like any other information, please see our website at foreignlanguagehouse.com. I'm Catherine Fortin, and good luck on your next class.